Thanks for coming to our website to watch our video. I thought it'd start off with some depressing music and a lot of dead ash trees. This is the long version. We have a short version for those of you who already know they want to treat their tree, but this one is for people that are looking for more information. I've tried to make this somewhat entertaining, informative, and convincing. What I want you to take away from this is, number one, if you have an ash tree, it is going to die unless you treat it. And it's happening right now. Number two, if you decide to treat it, you need to do it now. So keep watching and I'll explain why. I really don't care if you treat your tree or remove it, but I want you to be informed so you have a chance to make that decision before Emerald Ash Borer makes that decision for you. What you're watching right now is a subdivision out in West Burlington. And they got a little bit carried away when they made the subdivision. First of all, lots of trees. They like trees, but they only planted ash trees. So we've removed every tree in this entire subdivision over about five different properties. This yard right here had, I think, 13. And the one next to it right over here to the left of that picture, I think were 10. And the one at the top of the picture that we're coming right towards right now had 16, believe it or not. And yeah, and you know, like I said, every single ash tree dies. There's one across the street that had about five, and there's one back here in a field. And we've actually got video coming up here where you can see those being removed. But they're all gone now. And we've got some pictures showing up to show you. Coming up to show you, but yeah, every one of them is dead. This is a picture of me hanging out on a tree. This is a picture of me cutting down a tree. This is my certification from the International Society of Arboriculture. That makes me like a tree guy with a badge. And this is my badge. This is my pesticide applicators certification or license, whatever you call it. And our business is also certified. I'm kind of a tree geek. I've got lots of books and stuff that I've read, so I know a lot about trees. I want to keep this video entertaining, so I've included several of our larger and more difficult, more unique removal jobs. This is the property from the introduction. This is the yard right here that had 16 trees in it. We took the three trees out by the road so we could get a 50-ton crane in the yard. And then we picked out entire trees with a 50-ton crane. You can notice little stumps in the yard, but this tree right here, you can see it came from between two sheds. And there's a fence back there too, so these are fully grown, you know, mature trees. They're not tiny by any means. They're not huge, but they're like 50 feet tall, about 30 inches in diameter probably. But so 13 trees that day. It was a long day, 8 or 9 hours, so we're averaging about 40-50 minutes a tree, picking them up with a whole crane, setting them down in the street, cutting them up, stick them in the chipper, and then you'll see the customer kept all the wood, stacked all the logs next to the house. So this is our last tree. You can see the power lines in the foreground. Those are three-phase transmission lines. Danger, danger. So since I was involved in the tree job and not able to fly the drone the whole time, we only got a couple trees with the drone video. But as you can see, quite a job to get done in one day. Cranes are pretty amazing. So here goes another one. And that's all they all came out. To the left of the screen, farthest from the crane, we had to take a couple of trees in smaller pieces, but most all these trees came out in one piece. Went up, rigged them, and cut them at the bottom, and let the crane set them down the street. these are the aftershocks of this entire neighborhood. And we cut down all the ash trees on about five properties here. And obviously, it's not economically intelligent or feasible to save every single tree, but you know, two or three trees in each yard would have shaded these houses, and they're in full sun now.
What we're looking at here in the backyard.
Here's another short video of another dead ash tree. This one in a really difficult location, a fenced-in yard with nice little landscape trees underneath it. Single car, single driveway, so we could get the bucket truck in there, but nothing else. So it made so much more sense to do it with a crane. All the pieces of the tree went up and over the house and sat down in the front yard, right behind the chipper. Be quickly processed. And you'll notice when we do crane rigging, the limbs come off of the tree in the same orientation, same angle as they were when they're attached to the tree. That's the goal anyway. And if you do it right, you do it well, that's the way it happens. Watch this shot right here, for instance. There's pretty much no movement in this limb whatsoever. It just gets picked right off of the tree, exactly the way it was. And the reason it needs to be that way is you don't want to shock load the crane. Crane operators get upset when you do that. So this is the end of the tree right here. It's getting lifted up and out of there. And this whole job only took us a couple hours.
Still look fantastic.
This is another removal job we did with a crane. This is one of the properties from the introduction. Sometimes trees attack. So that was pretty funny, huh? My crane operator didn't see the drone in the air and swung the tree right into it. So after he started attacking my drones, I figured we better get our own crane. So this is our 26-ton crane that we just acquired, and that's our own operator, Tyke. And he's on the crew every day, and we've only done a couple of jobs with this crane. But anyway, these are a few shots that we've done with that.
Good morning.
So here's another difficult job we did behind a house in a big ravine, and these were a pain to get out of there, but it was a cool job. So anyway, there's going to be lots of information coming up in the video about trees we've treated, with lots of pictures and video of those, and various rates of success depending on how early we get to treat them. But most of the trees we have treated are doing great. And won't have to be removed like these.
Yeah, beautiful. Here it comes back in.
What's happening here is what we call an SRT ascent. It's a stationary rope technique. I've got a rope tied off in the top of the tree. And I've got to climb up there, and I'm actually just climbing up the rope. I'm not really even touching the tree at all, but by use of foot ascenders and you know, high-tech gadgets that we have these days, you have the ability to walk right up a rope. It is a little tiring, but I had to get to the top of this tree just to cut a couple of limbs off, and you will see the right side of the tree when we drop it, and it just misses the neighbor's oak tree. Feathered perfectly, so it's a pretty cool shot I wanted to show you.
Time to rest. Couldn't quite make it. Holy shit. Yeah, that was fine. That's nuts.
This is the shot I was talking about. This is the same tree I just dropped, but from a different angle. So watch the right side of the tree, how it perfectly shapes around the neighbor's oak tree. As to not to harm that, and also misses our client's bushes and lands in the ravine. And we did get all these logs out of the ravine, too. I had to pull them out using a pulley to a tree up on top of the hill, and then use a bobcat to take them out in the front yard and get rid of them. So this customer had 11 ash trees lining their driveway. And obviously they're all dead and they had to be removed. We call this little machine Gizmo. He got the nickname from a grouchy neighbor who yelled at us, "You're not going to be driving that little Gizmo in my yard, are you?" Gizmo is a mini articulating wheel loader. He's not as big as a golf cart, but he can lift 2,000 pounds and has a telescoping boom that can lift logs and brush 11 feet in the air over all sorts of obstacles. He is a rock star. He also has about 13-inch wide turf tires, so he can drive around on soft, wet terrain, and you'll never even know he was in the yard. They also had one tree, one or two, there's two of them back there, behind the house that didn't have room to flop those, so I'd climb up those and just drop a few limbs off, and then we had room where we could drop them. So after the job, we ground the stumps on these, cleaned everything up, put dirt back in the holes and grass seed, and I went back to get after pictures just last week. This is the largest ash tree we ever had to take down, and look at this picture. This is from the top of that, looking over Fort Madison. It was literally the tallest tree in town, and this is my first trip up it. When you use a crane to get to the top of a tree. You don't have to climb it. This is my buddy Brad, and when we have extremely large trees, I'll have him come down, and we'll tag team these. I'll go up and set slings and rappel all the way down to the ground, and he stays in the tree and makes the cuts. So we kind of share the work, and otherwise it'd be an awful lot of work. Especially a tree like this. This tree took us 3 days with the crane, and then another entire day of hauling all the wood off, which there's some pictures here of the wood. There's me and the ninja right there. Call him the ninja. But look at the size of this tree trunk. Now those are big houses, and you can see the retaining wall right there. So we used the 50-ton crane again, and the crane was set up 80 feet from the trunk of the tree. So some of the picks up toward the back of the house were, you know, about 100 feet away from the crane, which is pretty extraordinary. We had a great crane operator. Although it's not an ash tree, everybody wants to know what's the biggest tree. Well, this is it. Check this thing out. There's Brad taking a little break in the tree. And this next picture, if you look close, right in the center of the picture, there's both of us. We're wearing green shirts. That is one tree. So that one, that was the biggest tree in Burlington. So now we'll get into more of the education about the history of the Emerald Ash Borer and why it is so destructive. It was discovered in Detroit in 2002, apparently imported from Asian shipping materials. Since then, it's migrated in every direction, killing hundreds of millions of trees. It was first discovered in Burlington in July of 2013, and then confirmed in Lee County in July of 2015. The adult beetle does no harm to the tree, just feeding on the leaves. However, the adults lay eggs in the tree, and the larvae feed on the cambium, which is basically the vascular system of the tree, and eventually kills the tree within about 4 years. It is important to treat your tree before you see symptoms of emerald ash borer. We can treat with success if there's about 70% of the canopy still alive, and you will see evidence of that later in this video. But the tree has been damaged, and it will be stressed, leaving it vulnerable to insects and pathogens. Treatment can still be successful, but at this point, it's more of a recovery and not just as preventative. So, the most important thing I want you to take from this, do not wait until your tree shows signs. Once your tree has dead branches in the canopy, you also have the cost of pruning out dead branches in addition to the cost of treating it. If you have an ash tree that you want to keep, you need to call us now and get on the schedule. Do not wait. We can treat your tree from the middle of April till the end, well into the fall, as long as the temperatures remain above 40 degrees. But the best time is mid-April till mid-May, when there's ample moisture in the ground. But the larvae hatch and begin to feed in mid to late June and feed all the way through the summer into late fall, getting larger and eating more day by day until they go dormant for the winter. But the next spring, they will awaken and resume their destructive feeding until they emerge as adults in any time from mid-May until the all the way to the end of July. So they're only alive about 7-10 days before they lay eggs again. Then the eggs hatch within a couple of weeks. The most damage is done in the spring and the fall when the largest majority are feeding. But their cycles vary some, so there are some almost always present and doing damage through the spring, summer, and fall. So don't wait. You're going to hear me say that a lot. If we treat the tree in the middle of the summer and conditions are dry, we'll just simply ask that you water the area around the tree thoroughly the night before, and we'll treat it the next morning. The cost to treat is $10 per diameter inch at the waistline of the tree, which is about 4 feet off the ground on most ash trees. This treatment will protect the tree for 3 years. So keep in mind, whatever the cost is, you can divide that by three if it makes you feel better. And remember, a tree that shades your house saves you money on your electric bill, because your air conditioner is going to run a lot more than if the tree was gone. And air conditioning will also make you feel better. Here's a little thing we made up to show you the progression of emerald ash borer populations in your tree.
Year number two, those 37 females were produced 2,775 larvae, which will in turn produce 1,387 new females. Year number three, this is when things start getting bad, and this is when your tree starts to decline. 1,387 females are going to produce 104,062 larvae, resulting in 52,031 new females. So year number four, this is when the trees, this is why there isn't a year number five. 52,000 females produce almost 4 million larvae. So, and there isn't a fifth year, so this number right here doesn't even matter. So we're fourth year, now this is based on just one female emerald ash borer laying eggs. So that's not really not realistic. Realistically, we don't know. Maybe your tree might have five in it. Well, if it has five females land in that tree and start feeding and lays eggs, then this number is going to become 20 million. So the moral of the story is, you have to treat your tree when it doesn't look like there's anything wrong with it. And that's what we're trying to do with this video, is teach you, the homeowner, the tree owner, that you have to treat this tree although it looks perfect. You can't wait until it's done, you know, until the damage is done. The other benefit to that, your tree starts to decline, so you're going to have dead branches in it. So if you do choose to save your tree after it already has damage, then you have to pay an arborist, whether it's us or someone else, then you have to trim out dead branches.
The first step in deciding whether to treat your tree is to look at your tree and evaluate its chances of being treated successfully. Then we will measure it, determine the cost, and then discuss the benefits of keeping the tree versus the cost of treatment, cost of removing deadwood if necessary, or if we can give you a quote on removal, complete with stump grindings, cleanup, dirt, and reseeding. Unfortunately, if you have an ash tree, you will need to address it one way or the other.
All right, so this is the ArborJet QuickJet Air, and this is the system we use. So like you saw there, we drill 3/8-inch holes around your trunk of your tree. And then we tap these in there with this little hammer and this little setter right here, like that. And we tap that into your tree, and it's barbed so that it gets in there nice and tight. And then the little diaphragm right in here, right there, that we just take this needle, goes into that diaphragm like that. And right now I've just got cleaner in the line, so it's like, you know, it's watered soap or whatever, so it doesn't hurt anything. A little bit of alcohol, and just like this. That injects, it goes up to 5 milliliters. So, with the stuff we're using, it only takes 4 milliliters per injection site. That's the Triage R10. That's $569 for that pint. So, anyway, one bite of one leaf kills them. And this uses compressed air. This little tank gets charged up, which is kind of getting low, but it's about 75 PSI is how we pump that into your tree. Want to see it again? Just like that. I can't make this feature documentary without a little shot of my arbor dog, Daisy. Daisy, what you doing? She goes to lots of jobs with us, don't you? She's made a lot of friends here in Burlington. She's probably the best dog in Burlington. You got an itch? You got an itch? Here. Got an itch? I love my dog. Look at the camera. Look at the camera. Show me a pretty face. Hmm?
So when I decided to make a video, I wanted to do a demonstration on this tree, because mostly because of the tree that's right next to it. It's about 50 feet from a tree that's absolutely, it's a goner. So anyway, we treated this one first about 3 years ago, but the conditions were a little too windy that day to get any good audio, so we're just going to do it this way. So anyway, here's your tree. We measure it, determine its size, and then from there we go to find out how many holes we're going to drill in it. Then we drill holes in the root flare, or the base of the tree. And the holes are about 10 inches apart, so a big tree gets more holes. This is the arbor plug being set in the tree. And then you simply inject each site with 4 milliliters of the ArborJet R10, which is a restricted use pesticide. I do have to be, certified pesticide applicator to inject your trees. Anyway, Connor Brockett, our new tree healthcare specialist that's going to be injecting trees also, under my supervision, he does not have to be certified as long as he's under my supervision. So, and I don't even have to be present, but I've trained Connor and he's done a great job, and it's very possible if you get your tree treated, he may be the one doing it.
I'm going to take a moment to show you the neighbor's ash tree that did not get treated, and it's on the schedule for removal. Obviously it's gotten brittle enough. You can see that broken limb hanging up there. Anyway, the telltale sign of emerald ash borer damage, you see missing bark in the top of the tree. That's from woodpeckers trying to get at the larvae. And so that's the telltale sign. This tree, you notice you see green stuff on it. You're thinking, well, you know, it's still alive. The green stuff sticking out of it are suckers, or the technical term we use is epicormic shoots. So that's the tree's reaction to starvation. The tree is not getting any food and nutrients, so it feels like it's starving, so that's why it produces all these suckers around the bottom of the tree. Like if you cut off a tree, you know, and the root system's still alive, it'll get epicormic shoots on it. So anyway, but virtually every single branch tip on this tree is gone. So all these branches would have to be removed, and yeah, it looks like over on this side of the tree there's one limb that appears to be somewhat normal. But this tree is just way too far gone to be treated. It's got to be removed. So, and this tree, you know, I'm not advocating, you know, telling everyone to save every single ash tree. You know, it depends on where the tree is located and how it benefits you. This tree is right on the west side of the house. So this tree shaded this house and the driveway all late evening, you know, in the hottest part of the day. So this tree's gonna be missed, and the air conditioning bill is gonna go way up when this tree is gone. And in contrast, here's the tree that we've treated. This tree was treated in 2017, the first time, and it did have some damage. We did prune a lot of deadwood off of it, and it's completely recovered, looks terrific. And all the damage is pretty much healed up, and don't anticipate this tree ever having any problems again. today is the day. Here's our tree that was treated, doing wonderfully. And there's the tree about 60 feet from it. It's its last day being a tree. It's gonna become wood chips. Well, it's going to a big pile somewhere. It's gonna be firewood. Firewood is nice, but it doesn't really provide shade for your house. You can't really sit underneath it and have a cold glass of iced tea on a hot day. This guy right here, this isn't my crew. This is Leonard Bowden. He's been cutting down trees in this area for about 40 some years. He's teamed up with Stu and his crew. They're both tree contractors from the Burlington area. And we've all been swamped with the ash borer over the years. It's good for business. The emerald ash borer has definitely been good for business. Look out, Stu! Well, the crew's been on the job here for about 3 hours and the tree's half gone. And the cool thing about it is look how nice we can see our tree that's been treated and is thriving over there. We got a much better view of our tree now. Well, I came back to the scene of yesterday's ash tree execution, I guess, or put it out of its misery or whatever. But yeah, it's about 1:30 in the afternoon, and they got a little porch there, but anyway, no more shade on the back of this house. And it was 1:30 in the afternoon. I'm facing south, so as the sun turns around, and you can see there's our beautiful ash tree that we've treated and saved, by the way, and look how shady our customer's house is right now. But anyway, yeah, that sun's going over there, and it's gonna bake this house all evening, all afternoon and all evening. And it's hot out here. It's like 90 degrees today. It's the 4th of July, and it's just a shame. And I reached out to the people and tried to get them to treat this tree, but it was an awesome tree, freaking totally awesome. You saw it. But the deal was, this is a rental house. They weren't gonna spend any money on it. And and the renters are gonna pay the electric bill. So if you don't think that makes a difference, all this sun beating down on the shingles, cooking the space above the ceiling, it makes a huge difference in your electric bill. This tree is about 40 inches probably. Yeah, it would have been about a 40-inch tree, so that'd be $400. To treat it every 3 years, about 120 bucks a year, somewhere in that range, 125 a year, divided by 3, 130, something like that. About $130 a year is what it would cost them. And in the summer months, not just the money savings, just the comfort. Come out here in your yard and just be in the shade. Whew, I'm gonna go over here because it's quite frankly it's hot out. And yeah. No, this is nice. This is nice. So, yeah. Yeah, tree's doing great. This tree's doing great, and I'm proud that we saved it. So you can do the same. If you have an ash tree, you need to make that decision for yourself. So I just got on my scooter. I'm going out taking pictures of healthy ash trees that I've treated today to show you guys. You'll be seeing them here in a minute. But anyway, there's our tree we treated, okay? I went half a block down the street, and looky what we've got here, which this is one of the largest dead ash trees in town that are remaining. They're mostly gone. Burlington has a forestry department, so we there's a nuisance program. The city forester contacts the city nuisance people, and they put a blue dot on this tree, whether it's in your yard or whatever, but if it's a threat to the public, they put a blue dot on it, and that means you get a letter in the mail, and if you don't cut it down in, say, 30 days or something like that, they'll send a contractor. They'll call me and or Stu's Lawn or Leonard Boughton or Ben Skelly, and we'll bid on it. They get at least three bids, and the lowest bid comes and cuts down your tree, and it goes on your tax bill. So you don't have a choice in the matter in Burlington, and I'd imagine wherever you live, something has to be done. You can't just have dead trees, you know, all over town. It's a hazard to the town's citizens. So anyway, thought I'd just point that one out to you. This is a nasty tree, and a tall one. I think we'll go have a look, closer look at it. So here we are. This is that tree, and you know, from here it looks alive. It's got a lot of you know, foliage down here. This green stuff you're seeing are mostly suckers. Suckers, the slang term, the proper term is epicormic shoots. And what the tree is doing is, this is a reaction to starvation. The root system and the tree's functions are not getting any nutrients and water. So the tree's reaction to that is to try to put on more leaves. So you see, like, none of these branches are really established. Most of these, this growth on the bottom of the tree, are just very small epicormic shoots that have grown off the stems, and they're not going to sustain the tree. I mean, this tree is a goner. Virtually every single limb tip in the canopy is done. This tree is gone. I mean, it's just a matter of time. It's kind of surprising that the city forester hasn't come by and put the blue dot on it, the blue dot of death, as I call it, because I get the phone calls from people like, I got a letter in the mail and the city put a blue dot on my tree. What's that mean? Well, it's coming down. Yeah, this is an awesome tree. Feels good in the shade. So, by the way, I guess it'd be a good time, if you don't know what an ash tree looks like, the telltale signs are the leaves. It has a compound leaf. That means it has one big leaf coming off a stem, and then there are several leaflets attached to that leaf. And ash trees have what we call opposing twigs. So if you look at the twigs, not in every case, like that right there, that's a single twig. But see right here, opposing twigs means a twig comes out each side of the branch. So, and then of course the gray bark like this. I mean, it's once you've seen enough of them, you know. And this is the exit hole, I believe, that the emerald ash borer leaves. Little D-shaped holes when they emerge. So this tree's riddled with them. Can't really zoom in with the lens I have on here and show you any other damage, but anyway, another nice big tree. She's a goner. Here's a shot from the other side of it. So yeah, as you can see, I mean, all the entire top of the tree is dead. It's gone. History. All right, we're over here at a client's house, and cool thing is, I messaged him. He lives out of town, but he kept this house, so it's a rental. But he cares about it, so he wanted to save this tree. And he wasn't in town, so I took him before pics. I'm like, yes, we can save this tree. So you saw the before pictures, so you remember how thin this canopy was. This tree was just about a goner. And if you look up there, you can see the damage, you know, is still there, but the tree is healing. And the tree's got nice full-size leaves now. It's got its nice dark color back. And you can see the limb right there that we took off was badly damaged, and you can see it's starting to compartmentalize and heal around. That's it right there where we took that limb off. But and it's got some suckers on it. You see the epicormic shoots growing up the stems, but the tree needs that. Those leaves are feeding the tree, so it's nursing it back to health. And you see, not sure how well you can see it, I hold this limb, hold the camera steady to see that limb, but all kinds of emerald ash borer damage in this thing. But this tree is saved. It's going to be fine. Tree's in the front yard. Nice little house. We're right by the park. That's Perkins Park right there. So it's, you know, it's a beautiful setting. Just adds to the aesthetic value of the house. No real shade value to it because it's on the wrong side of the house, but still, I mean, it's a tree, and trees do add to your property value. Because, you know, if you didn't have a tree here, you'd probably want to plant a tree. So it'd be great if it was over here in this part of the yard. So, you know, but he looking at the cost to remove that tree in a fenced-in yard with a nice iron fence that isn't coming out of the ground. You know, $1,200 to $1,500 to get that tree out of the yard. So cost him, what is that, 30-inch tree, about $300, $100 a year. You know, so he's out, it'd take 12 years. If we charge him $1,200, that's not including grinding the stump. So, got one little limb out there that didn't make it, I guess. When we pruned this thing, we got all the deadwood out of it, but that little limb's died off is all, but we pruned it at the same time we treated it. So, that, once again, you see all that cracking and stuff up in there? That's where the emerald ash borer was underneath the bark, and the bark's just kind of separated and falling off. But saved this tree, it's doing fine.
This is the before picture. You can see the dead branches over here on the right side by the bucket truck. And this picture, you can really see it a lot better. Look how thin the canopy is. You can see right through the tree. So the big limb on the left is the one that came off. This is the tree today. Thick and full of dark green branches. Leaves, I should have said. That's another shot of it, and this is another shot of it. So it's a pretty good looking tree again. This is a tree that we just treated the other day. It did have a little bit of damage in it, but look how it shades the little patio area. That would be a terrible tree to lose. This was a little bit of damage that it showed in it. That was in Sandusky. I believe that's the same tree. This is a couple of big trees that we treated at Lunning Funeral Chapel in Burlington, and you can see a totally dead ash tree in the background. This is a tree we treated. I think I got a little video coming up of this one, but we treated this one 3 years ago and just treated it again this year. And it added quite a bit of damage.
Alright. Very hard to keep the camera steady, but this is a tree we treated 3 years ago. We had to cut a lot of deadwood out of it. If you look close, if I can keep the camera still enough, this tree was riddled with emerald ash borer. I mean, it was, got it in the nick of time. And they're all the emerald ash borer damage is healed now. And there's like two dead limbs on the top of it that didn't survive. But this tree is going to be fine, and it shades their whole front of their house. So obviously, it's a tree they did not want to lose. I'm not sure if you're seeing that, but that limb up there. All along that limb, all kinds of emerald ash borer damage. And this tree's thriving now. It's got about one or two insignificant little dead branches in the top. And that's just because they were alive when we treated it, but the damage was too severe for the insecticide to take hold and the thing to recover. But this tree is going to be fine. We saved it in the nick of time. There's no way it would have made it another year, and it might not have made it another couple of months.
Up next, I have some video that I took from the bucket truck. And these are two really, really big trees that we treated 4 years ago.
Here's
and we had to take deadwood out of them then, and then we just treated them again this year. It had been 4 years, but this is the best video of extensive damage in a tree that we'd saved. These trees were really in bad shape, and we had to come back again and deadwood them again because so many limbs didn't make it. But the trees are alive. All the tops are good. They just had, you know, they were just in such bad shape. They had to spend money twice to get them deadwooded because they waited. But they're great trees. I mean, they spent probably $1,000 more than what they would have needed to had they treated them earlier.
And they're pretty much full size, great color. That's the stuff we're looking for. A lot of it's suckers. A lot of suckers on every stem, but they'll sustain the tree until it fully recovers. Well, I'm up here where I can get a great shot of some of this damage, so I might as well. This limb here didn't make it. You can see the damage down here in the base of it. Really bad. All over in there. But looky here. It's a tree we treated 3 years ago and had to prune it. Just had to prune it the other day. But look at all this damage up on this stem. And going up both stems. And this is all alive. We saved this. I mean, you know, it doesn't take a genius to realize this tree had emerald ash borer really, really bad. And we were able to save this tree. There was a lot of pruning had to be done. Not every limb made it, but this one had it bad. So, don't wait till it's too late. Just let me come treat your tree right now. Don't make me come back here and cut dead limbs out of it for 6 years. 3 years. I hate to sound repetitive, but look how bad this was. Look at that. This limb is all nice and alive. I had to trim some dead stuff off of it, but look at that. Up on top, on this side, down in here, it's on both sides. I already showed you the other side of this limb. That's where I just was. Damage just everywhere. And remember, this is all the compartmentalization that's happened. Eventually this thing will close. Eventually this is just going to close that and grow right around it. The tree will be almost as good as new someday with continued pruning. You know, it's got suckers everywhere. This is all your epicormic growth. That's an epicormic shoot. All these are epicormic shoots because the leaves on the end were dying. They were not supplying enough to the tree to keep it alive. And look at the shade. This is, she's setting up her tents down there, but she got a nice little grill. There's a little patio down there. The entire house. And by the way, this is one of two giant trees we treated here. So, canopy's all nice and alive. It's recovered. It was in bad shape. We're on the north side of Burlington, where we treated these 3 years ago, and 4 years ago. We treated these the first year I was treating trees, 2016. So we actually didn't treat them until this year. So these went 4 years, but they're in good shape. No sign of any recent damage in the last 3 years. All this is old. Okay, so we were up at the top of the tree. We're a little lower now. It's got a dead limb down here, but yeah, not just the small little limbs. I mean, this is almost a 10-inch limb going up through the canopy. And of course, I'm only showing you one side of it. There's damage everywhere in this thing. This thing had them bad. And yeah, here's your suckers. That's a great big sucker right there. I don't know. We're gonna leave it. I mean, it would be a ton of work to get them out for one, but we're just deadwooding and we're leaving the epicormic shoots on here because it's helping sustain the tree. Same tree. Look at the size of this thing. I mean, it's a big one. And look at all the shade. That is the southwest. Her door faces south at the southwest corner of her house. And you see right through there's the other tree. So if she didn't treat all these, just, you know, full sun all the time, but as it is, full shade all the time. So she spends a little bit of money to take care of two big trees, but like I said, look at all the epicormic shoots, all these that shot off these limbs when the tree was suffering so bad. And like I said, I think the tree benefits by having all these leaves, more carbohydrates for the roots, but And the other thing is, they'd have to pay us to remove them all. I mean, it'd be tough to maneuver around here with a bucket truck. You'd have to do a lot of climbing or whatever. So to clean up these trees and get rid of all these shoots would be a tremendous job in itself. So yet another reason not to wait. Because, you know, you can't really see through this tree anymore. It looks like a giant bush from, you know, in the bottom of it. But it can be cleaned up. I mean, we've done it before, and we can do it. But more money, more money. I'm a busy arborist, no doubt about it.
This is an ash tree we treated for the city of Burlington. This is in one of our parks. This is a tree I treated for a customer out by the airport on the south side of Burlington. And this is another shot of the same tree. See, they have a swing underneath it. And this is another tree that's in their yard, just a short distance from the other one.
So here's two trees we've treated. This would be the, we just treated them for the second time a couple of days ago. Anyway. Nobody wants to sit in a swing in the sun, but a great big, tall, beautiful ash tree here. 100% healthy. We didn't have to trim anything off of this one or nothing. And then a little cultivated ash, some kind of like a purple ash or something. But anyway, nice little tree. We just treated this little guy the other day, and it's great. I mean, full canopy and everything, and couldn't be better, really. But I want to show you something. When we were here treating this, where was it? Yeah, so there's emerald ash borer damage up there. You can see, and those are frost cracks. But right, where is it at? Where is it at? Oh, right here. All right, right there. You see that? Okay, that's emerald ash borer damage. And you see this stuff around it? Looks kind of like scar tissue. And that is what we call wound wood. Once the ash borer damages the cambium, it's not going to have bark on it ever again. That wood is pretty much dead. The wound wood around it is new cambium and compartmentalizing that wound. So this has about, you know, three layers of cambium around it. And eventually this tree will completely seal that wound as that wound wood continues to grow. So the tree was saved. It would no doubt in my mind be dead because that was 3 years ago. And if you've seen the math on this thing would have like 3 million, 3 or 4 million emerald ash borer in it by now. So the tree's fine, but that's what happens. There's a little bit of other damage up in here. You can see on these, like there's some right there. But we treated these trees. There's our fresh holes. We still got little stuff right there where we drilled the holes in it. So there's our plugs in there, and there's one right there. So this tree is going to be fine, and we're facing west too. So when this tree gets bigger, it's not big enough to shade the house yet, but it's going to. The sun is right up there, so this tree keeps growing and gets bigger. It's going to shade the house a little bit. By the way, this is my baby. This is my arbor scooter. There's my badge right on the front of it. So when I get a phone call, and I get calls all the time, but when I have to go out and do bids, I jump on my arbor scooter, and this thing goes, it's a 600cc Honda Silverwing, so I'll be there fast. That thing goes like 120 miles an hour, and it feels pretty good to ride it too. So anyway, it's the 4th of July, it's about time for me to go out on the river. So hope you've learned a lot watching my video, and I hope you make the right decision when it comes to your ash tree. This or
not the wood chipper. There's the chip truck, firewood pile, or the log pile to become pallets.
At this place we have a couple of trees we treated 3 years ago. They're due to be treated again, and we haven't done anything to them. This one right here, it's on the south side of Burlington, which ash borer came to the north side. So 3 years ago these weren't in too big a trouble yet. But, I mean, they had ash borer in the canopy. We haven't done any pruning on these. The leaves on these trees are just a tad smaller than they would have been. They were damaged. But this tree, the top didn't make it. We treated it, and we gave it a good dose because we knew it was infected, but the top of the tree just didn't get the insecticide up there because it was too far damaged. Emerald ash borer does start in the canopy of the tree, the top of the tree typically, and works its way down as populations increase. So this tree does have established branches that are still alive. Like that tree I showed you before, you know, all those were just suckers, but like that's an established branch that's 100% still alive. The tree of the little dead limbs on the underside, that's just because they don't get sun. This tree does have some sucker growth though. Look along the trunk. You see there's a lot of sucker growth in it because it was starving and threatened at the time. And so anyway, it's somewhat recovered. I haven't talked to this client yet about what we're going to do about it. We can just take the top out of the tree and, you know, leave it the way it is. I mean, it shades the yard, shades part of the driveway. It's on the east side of the house, so it's, you know, morning shade for this part of the house, this part of the driveway. But this tree we saved, and this is a cool place. I got lots of trees. Beautiful, nice maple right there, and a nice maple here, and that's a big walnut. So, yeah, it's a cool place. So, just minimal deadwood in that tree, but it's been saved. And I don't know, I don't have the right lens on here to zoom in and find any previous damage on it, but so I'm just showing you the various stages of which we can save trees and what kind of success we might have. We saved the tree, but what's it going to cost us to come and take this top out without damaging anything else? It's going to be a few $100. So I'd imagine they're going to save this tree, but anyway, it's going to cost them more than it should have had they treated it earlier. So, another shot of that tree from the road. So yeah, you can see the top didn't make it on that one, just a little late, but we can save the tree still. I'm at our shop and I'm going to give you a quick look around some of the equipment we have. This is kind of our pride and joy. This little baby right here is an articulating wheel loader. You've seen in some of the videos of it and what it can do. Well, today it's holding up it's holding up the rear end of a 1964 Corvair. We have a mechanic here that keeps all my stuff running, and he uses the shop for his own little projects, and that way I don't have to pay him so much. But anyway, this is Gizmo, four-wheel drive, articulating, so it doesn't do any damage to turf. Got a trailer hitch on it, which will pull the stump grinder, and the little guy will lift 2,000 pounds and go almost 10 miles an hour through your yard, which is actually hauling ass if you're you know, in somebody's yard. That's fast. But awesome little machine, totally awesome. That's got a telescoping boom too, so it'll pick stuff up and lift it like 11 feet in the air. Goes over houses and garages and stuff. That's the RV, no real tree purpose to it, but this is our stump grinder, 50 horse diesel stump grinder. This is my trusty old Dodge 1-ton dually four-wheel drive, and it pulls a dump trailer, and there's our old Bobcat that with a grapple on it that'll lift, you know, that's for the big stuff that Gizmo doesn't want to lift. This is what we call the tree truck, the Ford, but it's got all kinds of gear in it, and another dump trailer. So with both dump trailers and both trucks, we can haul a lot of wood. We got like 32 feet of space. This is the chip truck, and that's got a 16-foot bed, and that's a BC 1400 wood chipper. We can put up to a 14-inch log in it, and we can get several trees in this truck, the 16-foot bed, so it's very efficient. We can stuff a lot of trees in there before we have to go dump it. And this, brand new acquisition. I can't even drive it yet because I don't have a CDL, and with the COVID situation, I had to make an appointment to get take the test, but it's a 2014 Peterbilt crane with a national crane. That's a 26-ton crane. We can pick about 1,000 pounds out of the air, 50 feet in the air, about 75 feet from the back of the crane. So that is a very, very handy item to remove trees in difficult locations over the top of houses and in backyards and fenced in yards, stuff like that. Just got that thing, came from Texas, super clean unit, but the demand for our services is so high that, I mean, just to keep up, I was renting cranes all the time for the last 5 years. We don't even have our Texas plates off of it yet. But I've been renting cranes for 5 years, and it just got to be the point where it made more sense to own our own. So So that's got 125 feet of boom. And incidentally, I mentioned what it can pick at 75 feet away. Now, if you're right next to the tree, if we can, you know, get a tree in a front yard or something, we can pretty much pick up the whole tree. It's got a capacity of, well, 26 tons with enough lines on it. These are dead ash logs. And the other day I saw one really good example of how, oh yeah, here's one. Here's a little ash log here that has been devoured by emerald ash borer. Look at that. So that is what the emerald ash borer does to your ash trees underneath the bark. So yeah, this is the layer, this is the cambium layer, where nutrients go up to the leaves, feed the leaves, and the leaves in turn feed the tree root system, keep its processes alive, defenses, stuff like that. So yeah, so that's why your trees are going to die, folks. That's why your trees are going to die. And there's our firewood processor, little wood splitter. So yeah, we'll make firewood out of it for you. So there's our little log yard there. So anyway, about concludes it. It's 4th of July. It's time to go out on the river. But anyway, as you can see, we're fully prepared to take your tree down for you, or we'd be more than happy to treat it for you. I got in this business because I like trees, and I like working outside, and climbing trees is fun, and being in the shade is fun, and it's so much more satisfying to, you know, save a tree so customer gets to retain it and enjoy it, then bring this thing over to your house and take it out and put it in the wood chipper, bring it back here and turn it into firewood. So anyway, like I said, off to the river.
Our bucket truck wasn't at the shop. We had left it on a job last week. But anyway, that's our bucket truck. Really nice truck. And also, I didn't get to show you, this is all our climbing gear. I'm a major gadget guy, so we have all the most modern equipment to climb trees safely, efficiently. We wear PPE. We wear helmets. This is all our rigging gear, which this picture is a couple years old. We even have more than that now. So, in closing, I just want to say there are other treatment options, such as soil drench products that you mix and pour in the ground around the tree. These can be effective and they cost less, but you don't know how much product evaporates or runs off in the ground and how much is actually taken up by the tree. The advantage of injection is obvious. It's injected directly into the tree's cambium where it needs to be, and there's no runoff. And we also use the most effective product there is on the market. I first started treating trees in 2016, about 3 years after the emerald ash borer came to town. So most of the ones I treated were somewhat threatened, but some were pretty healthy. We've saved around 300 trees, but sadly, we've cut down many more than that. And some were just really great trees that people would have loved to have kept. You know, I can tell you several stories about people who are just literally so brokenhearted. A lot of people didn't even know what was wrong with their tree. And when I showed up and told them, I said, well, this is an ash tree, and yeah, it's probably too late. If you treat your tree now while your tree is still healthy, you'll have to treat again in 3 years and probably again in 6 years. After that, when most of the healthy ash trees will be gone, so the food source for emerald ash borer will be greatly diminished, we can probably at that point just go into an observational mode and just monitoring all of our healthy trees. And then if there's a resurgence in your area, we may have to treat again. I hope you've learned a lot watching our video, and I hope you can recognize, or you learn to recognize, an ash tree. So if your neighbors or someone you see down the street has an ash tree and they don't know they need to act now, please let them know. Send them to our website and urge them to research themselves. They may be super appreciative someday. Maybe they'll just blow you off. I've had that happen to me a lot too. But as I mentioned before, we've just hired Connor Brockett. He's going to focus on the plant health care aspect of our business. And we've already treated about 50 trees together, so he knows exactly what to do. And he's really excited about learning more about not just emerald ash borer and saving ash trees, but he's also going to specialize in all aspects of plant health care. You can call or text Connor directly at the number you see here, 319-850-7068. Thanks for watching, and I hope you enjoyed it.